of the esophagus. In this, we shall be covering gastroesophageal reflux disease, esophagitis, esophageal motility disorders like achalasia, spasm, rings, webs, carcinoma of the esophagus, and miscellaneous disorders like Mallory Weiss and Boerhaave syndrome. Esophageal, as you know, is a muscular tube, and the main function is transmission of food from the mouth to the stomach. So when you have an esophageal disease, patient can either have pain due to swallowing, due to some obstruction or some acid disease, or they can be impaired function, that is difficulty in motility of food from the pharynx to the stomach. So the common symptoms of esophageal disease are heartburn, epigastric pain, regurgitation of food, chest pain, nausea, vomiting. Now the difference between regurgitation and vomiting is that in regurgitation, undigested food particles come out from the esophagus back to the mouth, whereas in vomiting there's actual retching. The stomach contents are coming out up to the mouth by a retching phenomenon. Besides this, patient can have difficulty in swallowing, that is dysphagia, or pain during deglutition, that is audinophagia. Also, a global sensation, a sense of suffocation, or a water brash where there is a bitter, sour liquid in the mouth during at any time of the day, that is called water brash. The most important symptom of esophageal disorders is dysphagia. Dysphagia can be for solids and liquids both, or only solids. And again, we can divide them into progressive or non-progressive dysphagia. When you come to solids and liquids, progressive dysphagia is seen in achalasia and scleroderma. In non-progressive dysphagia for solids and liquids, you can have a diffuse esophageal spasm. Dysphagia of solids only can be progressive or non-progressive. In progressive, usually there is stricture or a malignancy which is causing a narrowing of the esophagus. And in non-progressive, there is a esophageal ring which is there for quite some time and it remains the same, but the dysphagia goes on increasing slowly. Now coming to the first disorder, GERD or gastroesophageal reflux disease. As you can see in this diagram, you have a lower esophageal sphincter at the junction of the lower end of the esophagus and the stomach. Now this is responsible for preventing reflux of the gastric juice back into the esophagus. And this is a physiological entity rather than anatomical entity. Normally, the lumen pressure in the stomach, in the esophagus is more than the stomach, so the contents go down into the stomach. So whenever this lower esophageal sphincter is incompetent, so it is not able to contain the food into the stomach. So as a result, you get a reflux. So we are coming to the first disorder, that is gastroesophageal reflux disease. It can be because of anatomic defects like hiatal hernia, where there is a gap, an increased gap in the diaphragm. So part of the stomach comes up into the thoracic cavity. This can be just connection with the stomach directly or some other part of the stomach that is called a sliding or a rolling hernia. So you can have a hiatus hernia. They can be connective tissue disorders like scleroderma, where you can get reflux disease. This is often asked in the MCQs. There are also certain drugs which increase the reflux because of lowering of the esophageal tone. And that can happen with nitrates, anticholinergics, calcium channel blockers, coffee and alcohol. Now, how do you evaluate this? Obviously, the acid is coming back into the esophagus, so you have to monitor the pH, and that is the gold standard. You can diagnose the disease by that. And you can also do an esophageal manometry to analyze the resting pressure at this sphincter. So this pressure is low, then there is a reflux which is happening, which is causing the reflux disease. And other thing which you can visualize directly is a gastroscopy or OGD scopy, which shows signs of esophagitis. They can also see a Barrett's esophagus, which we're going to discuss shortly. Hiatus hernia, I already said, part of the stomach either connecting to the sphincter or a paraesophageal hernia can be there. And also at the same time, you can exclude other disorders like malignancies. How do you manage? As I said, the acid load on the esophagus is more, so you have to suppress the acids. And the mainstay is antacids in terms of proton. If the patient does not respond, you can offer surgical therapy to these patients whenever there is strictures because of continuous acid insult or there is a change like Barrett's esophagus. Surgical procedures that are offered are fundoplication. You plicate part of the esophageal end and the stomach so that the opening becomes narrow, the sphincter becomes tight. This can be Nissen's fundoplication or it can be partial fundoplication. As the disease goes on, untreated or uncontrolled, patient will develop erosions. So it is called erosive or even ulcers. So erosive and ulcerative esophagitis. It goes on further, it can narrow. They are called esophageal or peptic strictures. It can change. The cells can become different. So that is Barrett's esophagus. And this can predispose to an adenocarcinoma. Now, what is Barrett's esophagus? This is again very important for your MCQs. Prolonged reflux, a prolonged GERD, will change the esophageal mucosa from the normal squamous to columnar. This is called intestinal metaplasia. And this is not good because this is a pre-malignant condition for adenocarcinoma. The incidence is higher in males, in whites. It increases with age. And because the reflux is maximum at the lower esophageal end, the incidence also is maximum at the lower esophageal site. Diagnosis by endoscopy, gross appearance is salmon pink appearance, but you should confirm with a biopsy. So you take multiple biopsy because one site may not pick up the malignancy or the transformation of the squamous cell to columnar cells. Prolonged can cause stricture and that will cause dysphagia. There can be peptic ulceration here. And whenever there's early metaplasia, you should subject the patient to early esophagectomy, which is definitely required. Coming to esophagitis, some of it we already discussed. This reflux esophagitis because of hiatus hernia. This can be sliding, direct pull or rolling type, that is paraesophageal. Besides this, there are also infections which can cause esophagitis. These being candida, varicella zoster, HIV infection and cytomegalovirus. Also, corrosive ingestion accidentally or purposefully for suicidal intention, radiation therapy for carcinoma of larynx, pharynx or even lung can cause esophagitis. Pill-induced, we shall be discussing in NSAID-induced gastropathy, can also affect the esophagus and cause esophagitis, especially aspirin, steroids. And sometimes food and foreign body impaction, which is goes unnoticed, the patient is not very discomforted, so remains impacted, can later on present with severe esophagitis. Coming to esophageal motility disorders, these are mainly diverticuli, diffuse esophageal spasm. They can be also hypertensive, lower esophageal sphincter. In achalasia, there was decreased tone. They can be an increased tone. There's something called a nutcracker esophagus. And the most important is achalasia. In all these disorders, there is a defect in the propulsion of the food from the mouth, pharynx to the stomach. So whatever is the cause, the food is not going completely or easily to the stomach. So different disorders are described. The first one is Zenker's diverticulum. Again, this is asked often in the MCQs. It is a pulsion diverticulum. Now, as you can see in the second diagram, there is a place called the Killian's dehiscence. This is a pharyngeal mucosa going on to the esophageal mucosa. So this pharyngeal mucosa herniates. This is a weak area, you know, near the inferior sphincter. So this becomes weakened and there's a pulsion or a herniation. And this contains the mucosa and the submucosa. The entire esophageal wall is not there. This is a pseudo-diverticulum. Okay, and the mouth of the sac is in the esophageal opening. The food, instead of going down into the stomach, goes into this diverticulum. It's like an outpouching, as you can see over there. And it gets larger, the food gets collected. So patient starts having dysphagia because the food seems stuck over there. If it is liquid, it causes a gurgling sound. In fact, the gurgling sound is heard loud by the others also during swallowing. And after some days, that food which is collecting can get regurgitated also. And because of this food, all the time there is halitosis or bad breath. It is presentation is often at the age of 60 or more. Elderly people have this. And because the food is very close to the trachea, bronchi, there can be aspiration pneumonia. If it's for long, it can cause a lung abscess. And the treatment is actually quite simple if it's diagnosed. It's just excision of this diverticula and the patient feels better. We talked about achalasia, where you have dysphagia for solids and liquids both. And here something different is happening. The esophageal peristalsis is absent. And this lower esophageal structure, the sphincter, remains constricted. It does not relax at all. The tone is continuous. This is because there's something called Auerbach's myentric plexus. There's destruction of the nerves in this sphincter. So this sphincter remains closed. It remains closed most of the time. And if you do the manometry, in these patients, when the manometer is placed here, the pressure in the esophagus lower end is very high. The resting pressure is also very high. And this continuously goes on happening. Sometimes the sphincter relaxes, some food goes, but all the food does not go. And it is a risk factor for squamous cell carcinoma. Barium swallow, if you do in these patients, like you can see the third diagram, the esophagus is dilated and the lower part is narrow because the sphincter doesn't open properly. So this is called a bird's beak appearance or a rat tail appearance on barium swallow, dilatation proximal and then narrows down. And treatment is Heller's myotomy, where we sort of incise the sphincter so that some of the sphincter fibers at least release, and also partial fundoplication. You can also inject Botox, that is a toxin, nitrates, calcium channel blockers can be given orally, so these will all relax the sphincter. After achalasia, we discuss diffuse esophageal spasm. In this intermittent chest pain associated with dysphagia and often regurgitation. There's increase and decrease in pressure. So when you do a manometry, you find this fluctuation in the pressure in the esophagus. And as you can see in this diagram, there is a corkscrew appearance of the esophagus on barium swallow. This is again important for MCQs. The next disorder we're going to discuss is Schadsky ring. At this squamocolumnar junction, we have this ring over here sometimes, and this ring is there from birth. It can increase a little later at the lower esophagus, and this will cause intermittent dysphagia. Sometimes the esophagus relaxes enough so the food goes down, but sometimes it gets stuck over there, and the dysphagia is mainly for solids. This is often associated with the hiatus hernia, and the treatment is actually quite simple. You just have to dilate the esophagus at the point of this ring. But because of continuous or repeated food impaction, you can get halitosis, and it is also called the steak house syndrome, because undigested food often abroad it is steak, so it is getting collected, so the halitosis. Another important disorder is Plummer-Vinson syndrome. Originally it was called Patterson-Kelly syndrome. This is in the upper part of the esophagus, upper esophageal hypopharyngeal or a post-cricoid. It is a web-like appearance. Along with dysphagia, these patients have iron deficiency anemia, because of which they have choleonychia. They also have glossitis, and it is often seen in middle-aged women who present with anemia and dysphagia. Nutcracker esophagus is a super squeeze esophagus, where there is much more pressure raised in this, and this is called hypertensive peristalsis. One doesn't know real pathophysiology here, and all ages patients can have this. Again, the common symptoms are reflux and regurgitation. Treatment is relaxation of the esophagus while calcium channel blockers, nitrates and antispasmodics. Dysphagia lusoria, this is another important term where the dilated aorta is compressing the esophagus, and that is why the patient gets dysphagia. Coming to carcinoma of the esophagus, there are two types which are described, squamous cell carcinoma and adenocarcinoma. Out of all squamous